First of all, what I want to say to you, Joe, on this record, I think it's the best sounding record you've done. This Royalty album is really superb. You must be delighted with it. How are you feeling that it's about to be released?
You know, I mean, after we cut the first track at Abbey Road, you know, because it's all theory and reality. I mean, we hatched this idea with Pete Brown, Bernie Marsden at Abbey Road when we were there recording with Ginger Baker, the late Ginger Baker. Rest in peace. I hope he finds some peace. And I said, you know, I've had a few bad ideas in my life, but I go, this may not be the worst one. I said, what happens if I come over to Britannia and Bernie, you, Pete, and I, we'll let's write a record and we'll record it here at Abbey Road. And this was in 2019 spring. And we had all the plans to do it in July, and then Anton broke his foot, and we ended up moving it to January. So anyway, we ended up at Abbey Road, and we recorded the first song, which I believe was Royalty. I think it was the first song we wrote. And I heard it, like, just, you know, my band's real good, so we're a three-take, four-take band, you know, just kind of etch out the song, and we're good. And I heard it in the control room. I go, there you go. It worked because it sounded British to me and it sounded big. And, you know, we purposely recorded in the Studio A. Two reasons. One, Kevin likes a big room, you know, because we, like, you know, we did those Black Country Communion records at East West, which is a big room, you know. And you do get a big sound with big rooms, you know. And the other thing was Studio B, which is the Beatles room, has stairs. And I go, I already had a guy break his ankle on a golf course. I go, I'm not leaving anything to chance. I want a straight line from the keyboards from the drums to the control room. I didn't want anybody climbing stairs. You know, we are already $100,000 over budget because of an ankle. And it worked. You know, I was really thrilled. And, you know, one of the things is, and I've learned this, and I've known this for many years, but sometimes I don't apply it. The more work you do on the material before you go into the studio, the better off everything is. The more inspired the takes are. Because if the songs work, then all it is just apply what you know.
Sure.
Play. You know? And it was great having Bernie in the studio and stuff like that. And it was just, we just chiseled it out in a couple of weeks. And I think there's a, you know, one of the things, we just did our pay-per-view. One of the things, all the songs on the record will slot into the live show immediately. Like, to the point where we could open our gig the first hour. We can just do the record in its entirety.
It was definitely a vibe that I was getting there. I mean, I think that's the thing. It's bittersweet sometimes when you hear a record that's got that raw live element, and you always provide a tremendous live show as it is anyway, but you could really hear that. I was thinking, wow, you probably could just go, as you just said, go back to back. I mean, being able to hear, like, you know, Why Does It Take So Long to Say Goodbye? I mean, that and the Albert Hall.
You know,
that is going to be a vibe right there.
And you close your eyes and you kind of go, like, it's like you're visioning this stuff this will really work, you know? And, you know, I mean, I'm 45 records into my career, and this being the 45th, I mean, it's hard not to repeat yourself, but also you do have to embrace that you do have a bit of a style at this point, you know?
Yeah.
And I know what works for me is the big Gary Moore style ballads. They've always worked for me. It's just kind of in my wheelhouse. And, you know, that song, Why Does It Take So Long to Say Goodbye? You're like going, yeah, this is in my wheelhouse, you know, and having the luxury of writing something like that with Bernie was tremendous because of his take on the chords. You know what I mean? Like, I would write a certain, he would go to the minor seven, I would go somewhere else, and I'm like, that's much more British, Bernie. You must have been born here and wrote something like that. You know,
how is that process with him then? You know, do you tend to, well, for this particular project, I mean, did you bring, you know, because I know that, like you say, you like to be prepared, you like to go to the studio with Was it the same when you were entering these sessions with Bernie? Did you come with like 75% of the track and then he fills in the gaps, or was it all 50-50?
You know, I've learned a couple lessons in the last 4 years as far as writing, and it really brought home what I knew was true when we were in the final stages of Eric Gales' album, his new album, and which I co-wrote 90% of the record with people like Kev Moe and Tom Hambridge, James House, and stuff like that. And basically what I did with this album, I wrote a bunch of stuff down that I wanted to say. It's like, what do you want to say? Same thing with Eric. It's like he's very passionate about his positions and his things, and he would just go off on these tangents talking to other people, and I'd just be smoking a cigar, hanging out, not saying anything. I'm just sitting there writing shit down, you know. And then when you look at these titles or sentiments, you go, okay, well, here's one here, here's a song here. And, you know, and then, you know, on Royal T, you know, we had Pete Brown sent in a lyric right off the bat. It was like, you know, when one door opens, another closes on me. And I'm like, man, that's a really eloquent way of saying, if it wasn't for bad luck, I wouldn't have any luck at all. I go, it's a perfect blues sentiment, only written by a very, very legendary British songwriter. So once we started getting this stuff together, and then, you know, we had a pretty extensive pre-production. We had a pretty extensive pre-production phase. In the sense, we were, you know, Bernie and I wrote for about 10 days, and then right as we were about to start the record, Anton broke his ankle.
Sure.
We came back in January. We wrote for another week. Got songs like "Lookout Man," "Royal T." Thank God for Piers Morgan. You know, I was like, I don't know if anybody's ever said that, but thank God, because he was on. I wrote that song. I wrote the title song the day that Harry and Meghan left the band.
Right.
And he was on Good Morning Britain, and he was in a tirade. Right. He's holding up the Daily Mail, and he's like, royalty this and royalty that. Let me figure this out. Right. And that was the idea of the song. I'm not giving Piers a
no, no, team. Don't give him credit for anything.
No. But, you know, I mean, but you know, little do you know, I mean, like, we had Piers Morgan for about 7 years here in America.
Of course, yeah.
He took over the hosting job for Larry King.
Sure.
And I think we traded him back for, like, a Mini Cooper in, like, $6,000 cash, you know, when we gave him back.
Well, if you got a great album title out of it, it was worth it, you know?
Yeah, and I'm sure he's a nice guy, you know? You know, he's just, you know, like, one of the things that makes a good host is being passionate about your views. It doesn't mean that everybody's going to agree with you and they go, oh, he's a knob or whatever. It's like, at least he sticks the landing. You know,
it's very true. And no, I'm totally in agreement with that. I prefer people to be upfront with how they are. I think for him, it's right. Just that he's done some very naughty things. So, you know,
yeah. that's, you know, and I get in trouble because I'm opinionated too. But I wouldn't be, I would rather be your own person and have an opinion about something rather than, you know, I mean, when I was a kid, you know, the major label, you gotta go through media training and you see now there's a lot of crafted media people in interviews and they just stick the landing and it's just perfectly, perfectly neutral. They're not saying anything, but they're saying a lot of big words, you know?
For sure.
And so I ended up, I ended up getting in trouble at least twice a year for something that I say, because it's just one guy's opinion. It's not gospel, you know? If you don't agree with it, then prove me wrong.
Well, I think you're totally right with that. I mean, just to give you an opinion, personally, I think this is the best your voice has sounded on any record that you've done.
Thank you.
I mean, what have you been doing? Because you can hear the progression. It's always been a great voice, especially in a live setting. It's always a voice that works so well with your music. But there's clearly always a progression there that's happening. And with this one, there just seems to be a level of... Is comfortability even a word? I'm starting to use it, but there seems to be that level that's going on there. Was there a particular development here with the vocal between the last record and this?
Three things. One, I've always, you know, the guitar playing has been a staple of my life for the whole, my whole career. And it used to be was I would shout in key for a couple of verses, and then we would get to what everybody was paying for, which is the guitar solo. I made a conscious decision. I didn't want to do that my whole life. And in 2015, I met Mahalia Barnes, Jade McRae, and Juanita Tippins, who are they're not only great solo artists themselves, but they're nice enough to come tour with me and sing in my band. And when you have that kind of horsepower behind you vocally, you can't help but get better, you know? And one of the greatest lessons was ever taught to me long time ago by a guy named Danny Gatton. One of the many things that he would sit and pontificate about, and he was right. He goes, you need to surround yourself with musicians that are better than you. Because if you do, you end up becoming a better musician because you're hanging out with these musicians. And I accredit my singing improvements, if you want to call them, really, I would lay it right at Mahalia, Jade, and Juanita's doorstep because they keep me honest. I gotta hit the mark because I'm part of a triad, you know, I'm the lead singer and then there's a triad behind me.
Of course.
And sometimes we have two, sometimes we have three. It depends. It doesn't matter. And the other thing is part of having a four in the first number of your age. I don't know if you're 40 yet. Are you 40 yet?
Almost.
Okay. Cherish your 30s. I mean, I've had to have two surgeries, okay, since my 40s, and three, and counting the one next month. And then the morning after my 40th birthday, I woke up with a backache that I never had before. So cherish it. Part of becoming 40 is, and being in the business, this lovely fucking business for 30 years, is you accept who you are. You just have to go, you know, all you can do is be better. Now, there's going to be people that still think my voice sounds like some sort of like, decrepit air raid siren, you know, and that's okay. Nothing I'm going to sing is going to change their mind. It's already made up, you know. So once you accept that, and luckily enough, I've had good vocal instruction and I've studied what it takes to become a singer. My voice has gotten higher and cleaner and I've gotten more range because most of the times you come out in your early 20s and then you're singing the best you've ever sang. And then by the time you hit 40, it's like, you know, tuning the guitar down, you know, you're fudging the melodies. I've had good luck with my range and stuff like that. So.
Well, I was totally hearing it. As I'm listening to it, it was just every now and then there'd be these little moments that you could hear were just, I don't know, you might just go into like a little bit of a falsetto, or there'd be some tremendous power on a very high note with some tremendous vibrato, but it all felt very natural. It never felt like it was, this maybe sometimes where you can hear where, you know, a vowel needs to be changed a certain way to make sure that the pitch is correct and all that. I wasn't picking up any of that. I was just enjoying it and thinking, wow, it sounds like he's just having a fantastic time in the studio. I was giving all the credit to Abbey Road, basically. You know, that's what I was doing. What's so special about that building for you?
Well, you know, one of the things about having recorded at Abbey Road, there's two ways you can approach it. You can walk in there, and I like Bernie and I are writing, you know, at Abbey Road. This was last year. And you know, there's a legendary commissary at Abbey Road. You know, it's downstairs. The woman's been there for 45 years. They make a wonderful tomato and cheese toasty, and it's lovely. So Bernie and I were going in there for lunch, and we run into my friend Nick Mason. I've known Nick since 2008. I met him at a private party. He was mixing a live DVD that I think that they recorded at the Roundhouse in London. It was Nick Mason's High Flying Birds or something like it. I think it was all Syd Barrett era Floyd stuff that they were doing. And he invited Bernie and I into the control room in Studio 3. And I'm sitting there and I kind of know I knew that Dark Side was recorded at Abbey Road. And I'm just like sitting there going, you know, just making conversation. I go, have you ever worked in this room before? He goes, yeah, we did Dark Side here. I'm like, yeah, of course you did, right? So, and you start thinking about, like, Jeff Beck Truth was recorded at Abbey Road. The Beatles, you know, Star Wars. So what you have to do is you have to go into those situations that you go, are you going to let Abbey Road play you? Or are you just going to use it like everybody else as a world-class functioning studio? You can get the photo op at the end. Make a good record first. And that was my mindset, because a lot of times it's the same thing. The first time I played Albert Hall, I felt it played me. I was overwhelmed with the grandness of the event, you know. Eight times in, we played it, I think, eight times now. I walk in, I go, A, it feels smaller, which is odd. And B, you just go, I got this. I've been here before. I'll deal with the reverb and the, yeah. And it's part of the your progression as an artist. So, like, you start getting lucky enough to hit these benchmarks, you're more comfortable in that scenario. So we walked in, we just, like, set up the microphone, set up the gear, and record, you know? And that was, it was great.
Well, it makes a lot of sense. And what you're saying there is a tremendous point, with the fact that when you do walk into the building, there are these ghosts of great records littered throughout the halls and the studios. You've got old desks, you've got, you know, pianos that have been on Beatles records, as you're mentioning. Was there any desire for you to include any of the, you know, like for instance, the Lady Madonna piano that's there, to include anything like that from an old record on this one?
Well, you know, I mean, we used their piano, and we used our gear. We shipped it over, and, you know, I mean, they're happy to show you the John Lennon microphone that he sang, you know, Revolution on or whatever, you know. And there's the Hey Jude piano, or the, you know, Lady Madonna piano. It's upright. And I look at this stuff, and they're happy to rent you the console, the EMI console that Pink Floyd recorded. And you start looking at this stuff, and you go, you know what, as iconic as this gear is, you know what it's not going to do? Write the fucking songs. You know what I mean? That console is not going to write the Dark Side of the Moon for you.
No,
the only thing that those things do is exacerbate how shitty your songs are and how much work you need to do, you know? So, and I see it all the time, because I'm talking to you from Nashville, and I live a block from the Ryman Auditorium.
Okay.
And there's constantly people, like, you know, you see, you know, I follow the Ryman, and there's people like, my first time playing the Ryman, and they're taking selfies, and it's all great, because the first time I did, I was excited too. And the thing about that kind of thing, it's like your first gig or your first benchmark, chances are you kind of psych yourself out a little bit. You don't really get into really playing these places or recording in these places until you do it once or twice. And then you go, okay, I got this. You know, it's, you've taken the selfie with, you know, Roy Rogers and Minnie Pearl, the bronze statue in the lobby. You already got the selfie. Now just go play, you know?
Yeah.
It's a blessing, because I've been in this thing for so long and been successful enough to hit these benchmarks that I know how to not psych myself out in these scenarios. I recorded Abbey Road as well 3 or 4 times before we walked in there. So I knew the lay of the land.
Sure. No, of course. And I mean, as you say, hitting those benchmarks, you know, once you nail it, it lives on forever. But what is still left for you, bucket list wise? Because my God, you've gone through some list.
Well, you know, I got to be honest with you. I don't know what my career looks like coming out of this. I don't know what my life on the road looks like coming out of this. I do think my best records are ahead of me, and I really think that, because I've now had time and wherewithal and just experience enough to go, okay, this is what a good record should be, you know? And you don't want to just have 4 songs that end up in the live show and then the rest of it never sees the light of day. You want to make it a performance where you can drop the needle. I'm sounding old now. You drop the needle and it sounds like a gig, you know, and it's paced like a gig, and it, you take everybody. And I think my best records are ahead of me, writing wise and singing wise, at least for the next maybe 10 years. And then I'll just let myself go, you know, I'll just be like, who killed, you know, Joe, you know, Henry, you know, whatever, who cares?
Who ate Joe Bonamassa?
Yeah, who ate Joe Bonamassa? Yeah,
you can, you can have the Marlon Brando career ending, you know, style.
Yeah, you know, like struggling to move under my own power. Yeah. I mean, I have a whole goal. That's it.
You just show up for 5 minutes on some pop star's record, you know, get $1 million, you know. Now, you have
like that. Yeah. I mean, like, there's got to be, you know, 60 red peanut M&Ms and you know, Diet Coke and crystal glasses. You know, it's like we all strive for that.
That's no, absolutely. Now, you have had a long career, and you've had the pleasure of, you know, spending a lot of time with some greats just like yourself, who you've already mentioned, you know, Danny Gatton is one in particular. Now, you've had some great advice from these guys. Would you be able to let us know any bad advice that you've had from any of these guys over the years?
Bad advice? No, I wouldn't categorize it as bad advice. I mean, I run into a lot of people who are happy to pontificate to me as I'm happy to pontificate to others. There's certain things that, you know, people say to you and like, well, that works for you. That may not work for me. You know what I mean? One thing I would say about my heroes, you know, the ones I was lucky enough to run into early on, I'm not sure they would recognize the music business in 2020.
Okay.
You know, the difference between 1990 and 2020, it is so different. And in a lot of ways, it allows young artists to achieve notoriety without a lot of marketing dollars behind it. In other ways, it empowers people to have an opinion when they really don't have any basis to have such a strong opinion. And you have to kind of navigate through all of that, you know. And you know, there's Eric Gales and I were laughing, and not laughing, but we were making kind of a point where there was a certain pop star that posted a video of him playing an Eric Johnson song, and we watched it in the studio, and I was like, well, good, I'm glad, this is good for Eric, good PR for our friend Eric Johnson, who we love and adore, not only as a player but as a person. He's a sweetheart and just a wonderful person. And to Eric and I, that's our hero. You know, it's, to me, it's the two Erics, Clapton and Johnson, you know? And I maybe it was just early in the morning and I hadn't had enough coffee yet. And I just happened to mention Eric. I go, if you and I posted that video, the same level of playing, we would be roasted. Hmm. Absolutely fucking roasted. And I go, that's the music business in 2020. Because the comments were like, amazing, greatest ever, blah, blah, blah. We posted, you suck, you know, go home.
It's an odd thing, because we have got to this level where it's almost like if someone is, because if you were to do that, or Eric were to do it, it would be, you know, and I'm not convinced that that necessarily would happen. You'd have some haters, that's for sure, but I think the majority of people would be loving what you'd be doing. But it is odd that sometimes when you go past a certain ceiling, it becomes a little bit unrelatable to some people. Sometimes when someone sounds a bit shit, it's a bit like, oh yeah, I could do that. Whereas personally, I want my artists to be superhuman. I want to hear something that's like, Jesus, that's taken me, that's transcendent, it's taken me somewhere that I didn't expect I was going to hear on a record, not just from a technical standpoint, just from an expressive one, you know. So it could be an element of that, I suppose, but it is a scary thing.
Well, you know, I mean, the thing is like, you want to encourage everyone to participate, because the more people that are involved, the healthier the community. And you know, people like, you know, myself and Eric Gales, we've been around this thing for a long time, and we were playing well as kids, you know, and Eric's playing better now than he ever has. And it, it's, it's just part of a different type of marketing and business that is, you know, is slowly but surely becoming slightly unfamiliar to me. I used to be able to, like, okay, I can kind of gauge where everybody's at, but there's just now, it's just this flock of opinions that really, and it's like brain sorbet. You're like, I don't know what you're listening to. Maybe there's a latency on the video that you got, or what your, you know, what your point is here. It's like, if you don't like something, then fine.
Yeah.
There's a lot of players that are just not my cup of tea. And then there's stuff that I like that people go, I don't know why you get that. I go, I just get it. I feel it here in my heart. What are you going to do? It's subjective. There's no greatest ever. There's no ever, you know, I mean, I remember the comments about Stevie Ray in the 80s. There was always those flippant comments that would go around the guitar community going, oh, if I want to go see Albert King, I'd go see Albert King. Well, okay. You want to just dismiss it ad hoc. You know, you're like, wait a minute, you know. Yeah. But it's always been like that. The problem is if the 80s and 90s, those kind of comments would show up in like say the reader section in Guitar World magazine, sure. Somebody would write a letter. Okay, if that was like the Fender Champ. Okay, social media has brought the Marshall Stack. You know what I mean? It's like, wow, where did all you people come from with all this stuff?
Yeah. And unfortunately,
90% of it's positive and people dig it and whatever. But then there's the 10% you just go, whoa, that makes no sense to me.
It's definitely something that is going to be interesting to see how it develops over the next 20, 30 years. That's for sure. Hopefully, you know, it'll stop getting to this, that the negative rises to the top, because I think a lot of the time it's anonymity as well. People, you know, they wouldn't say these things. I mean, I'm it's low hanging fruit me saying that, but I think it is valid still. Just to touch on your guitar safari adventures.
Right.
I can't speak to you without finding out it's been a bit of a shit year, isn't it, for everyone, but I'm assuming you've still picked some bits up. What's been the highlights this year?
What did I find? I found not to sound flippant, but I work in the shadows of the guitar safari. Now, the guitar safari is really just me being on the road and, frankly, bored. And we just go in there with a vacuum and just hit every market and hit every guitar shop. And, you know, and they know when they see the silver bus show up, a potential buyers in the store, you know. So I've been very lucky in the stuff I found. But this year, I think one of the highlights for me was I bought George Kumans, the Golden Earring founder. I got his 59 Les Paul custom that the rumor is that, like, in his book he said I wrote Radar Love on my 59 Les Paul custom. I'm like, well, this is it, and there's pictures of him. Well, what I didn't realize was that he had bought it from Reggie Thielman, which they were Indonesian kids that had migrated came to Holland.
They were brothers, weren't they?
They were brothers. There's these famous videos of the drummer playing on the gold top, and they're crazy shit. Well, that's that guitar as well.
Holy shit. And,
you know, one of the things, it's like, you know, and that came to me through an email. Through my website, from a guy in Holland going, I got George Koyman's whatever. I'm like, so he sends it to me on spec. He packs it up in a box that I wouldn't send a pair of shoes in, okay? Let alone a 59 fucking Les Paul.
Yeah.
It's in a Yamaha case from like the 70s, like those like particle board with the little tin. I mean,
not amazing.
So. my guy Rick, he brings it to the house because we have it sent to a PO box, and I'm looking at the box and he's looking at me. I go, oh god. I go, I got $20. It says that this thing is now in not two pieces but three. comes right out of the case, no problem. And then we started going down the rabbit hole of finding out the guitar. We found all these pictures. And it's not stock. It's the wiring has been changed. So the middle pickup, you can add any position. It's had a rock star life, in the sense that most of these, you know, iconic late 50s Les Pauls that you'll see, very few of them are completely pristine in stock, you know, especially if they were a working man's tool. And they weren't expensive in the 70s. They were, I mean, you know, 300 euros or whatever. So, but it's that guitar. And then you plug it in and it sounds killer. You go, wow. You know, it's great when they turn out that way. And I've gotten a few things, a few mint things that came my way. But other than that, I mean, I have so much stuff. I'm only picking, kind of cherry picking what's coming my way, because at a certain point, it becomes critical mass.
Well, you know? I guess that's the thing, and it's difficult to turn it down when it is stuff like that that's always got a story behind it. And, right. You know, and you're a big mojo guy, so I would imagine with most of these, you feel that there's a song in there, especially when they resonate just right.
Yeah, and you know, I have two facets of my collection. The stuff I play live is not pristine or mint, you know. I refret some guitars because I don't like driving a car with bald tires, so you put the frets on it. And then there's hundreds of white glove museum pieces that I play at home or maybe occasionally in the studio. But you also have to be a custodian of history as well, you know, and it's like, I'm not going to play my mint Flying V when I can grab Amos that isn't mint and beat the hell out of it. You know what I mean? Yeah. I'm lucky enough to have three, and you know, and it's like, it's stuff like that, that you say to yourself, it's like, you know, where's it all going to go one day? Somebody's going to end up with it all. And that's fine by me. And that time may be sooner than later, you know, because at a certain point you go through your life and it's like, yeah, I got really deep into this thing. And I was like, wow, this is like super cool and killer. And then there's a point where you're just like, then it turns off and you're like, all right, that's kind of cool, but I never really play that. That's kind of cool, but I didn't really play that. And then you just kind of gravitate to the things you actually play.
Well, you know, Clapton let them all go at one point, didn't they? So, mm-hmm. You know, and I remember at the time thinking, I've never seen anything like that in my life. You can't imagine ever doing it. But I guess a lot of the time there's a pressure that's added with these as well.
You know? Yeah, and a lot of my collector friends, you know, they have a hard time letting stuff go because they feel that their identity is indelibly linked to the fact that they own all this stuff. Sure. And the thought of not owning it, meaning I'm losing my identity, you know, and part of that's true with me. It's like people know I'm a big guitar collector. So if I ever got rid of half of them, they're like, I thought you had to, I'm like, yeah, I did that in my 30s and early 40s.
You should have seen it. You should have seen it last year, you know?
Well, you know, the those guys at Reverb did a wonderful job when they went up to my house. This was in 2016. And people still call me and say, oh, I cannot believe your house. I go, dude, that was 2016. You should see it in 2020. I look at that video because I just happened to go back and I go, let me see what they're talking about. I went back and watched a little bit of it and that room looks empty compared to what it is now. Jeez. It looks empty. And then you start going, what the hell did I do to myself? You know what I mean? You know, all the amps that were in the atrium that were like different, like magnetones, whatever. I got rid of all of those because I had purchased so many tweet amps. Now all of them are tweets that go all the way around. And you're like, what have I done?
You know? You've just become the most, you know, like expensive hoarder on the planet. That's what it is. And obviously there's so much incredible gear there, but I couldn't speak to you without, you know, talking to you about the bursts. I mean, you know, right. Obviously there's much more to your collection than just that, but because of your you know sort of experience of playing these guitars, 58 to 60 Les Pauls. I mean, what are some of the things that would be surprising differences? I mean, a lot of people, you know, they'll talk about the different neck shapes or what have you, but what are the things from an expert's point of view that you might be surprised to hear are different?
Well, between, I mean, you know, I own 16 verse. I had 18, but I at the beginning of the year, and I was like, this is before COVID. I'm like, this is crazy. Like with a K and a double Z. So, two friends of mine, they were like, you know, they had been asking me for a couple of them. Hey, would you sell this one? I'm like, nah, not yet. And then finally I just. Like once I got 18, I was like, let's pare it down. What you don't realize, everybody thinks that a 59 Les Paul neck is standardized. They all feel the same. Wrong. One of the things is I own 59s in pretty much all the batches. Basically like an 0300. The first ones you'll see are like 0300s. They have kind of a bigger neck. More closer to a 58, but not as wide. As you get into like the 0600s, 0800s, the necks become slightly smaller. If you get into the 1900s, like 1945, 1948, which is mine, 1951, which is Skinner, and then you get into the 1800s, they vary because they were built in batches. They were built in batches of 40 and ish. And you start seeing the tops become similar. You start seeing the neck angles become similar. And then the same with the 60s, 0060s. Then you got like, you know, 0 1400s. Then there's a gap. Then they start back like where the Tommy Bolin guitar is, like 7495 or whatever. And then you start seeing it. So there's about five or six different versions just in 59 and 60. And I'm lucky enough to have played so many, not owned as many, but I've played a couple hundred. Mm-hmm. And one of the things is you start noticing similarities, but you also start noticing differences in the batches. And one of the things about Burse, they're not all great, but if you get one, that's amazing. There's nothing like it. But I also will say that the best sounding burst that you will play is your 335.
Interesting. Very, very, very interesting. In particular, you know, you've always got a tremendous neck pickup. So, I mean, all the good, you know, your tones are always pristine. Obviously, that's a big specialty of your sound. But I'm always amazed at how you get such a great neck sound on the humbucking pickup, because a lot of the time when I pick up the majority of guitars that have a humbucker in the neck, it's quite a dull or a muddy sound, but you are always able to get tremendous bite and clarity. Is that something that you've particularly worked on, and is it something you're aware of?
So your pick technique is very, very critical. Like I can brighten up a guitar, and I can take the edges off just by how I attack with the pick. I set my amps pretty neutral. Like, I don't like a lot of top end, but it has to be bright enough to where it's just not just sludgy. And what you do is you end up trying to figure out a good relationship between front pickup and back pickup, you know? And there's some that are just too overwhelmed, both on reissues and whatever, and they just get very tubby. Then there's, you know, ones that are just perfect. And you can, all you have to do is just raise and lower the pickup a little bit, not by much. You don't have to get all analytical. Just take the pickup down in the front and raise the pickup in the back. So you just get a little less output from the front and a little bit more in the back. So it cleans up a little bit, and then it bites when you hit the gas. And the other thing about guitars is using all the options you have on the guitar. Tone, you can roll the volume off a little bit, it gets a little cleaner. And then, you know, I rarely solo with the guitar on 10. It's probably between 8.5 and 9, because I like a little bit of roll off on the top, and I like it cleaner. Sometimes if it's too gainy, it just, you don't get the articulation that that I, you know, I like a guitar with immediate articulation, no squish. It's got to be, it's almost like playing it without plugged in. It's, you know, it's got to, because I have no legato skills at all. Zero.
No, zero.
Zero.
I watch, I don't, like, believe, Alan, I don't believe that for a second.
I watch Alan Holdsworth, and I'm like, I don't get how he's doing that. Like, yeah. How you getting all those notes in that he's picking, he's not picking a lot, and he's getting all these notes, but they're all the same intensity. See, if I back off on the attack, on the pick, things start, they just fade away. Like Eric Gales has got tons of great legato skills. That's why when he picks up an acoustic guitar, or he picks up a Strat, or he picks up anything, he sounds like Eric Gales. I've never seen anything like it. You know, Eddie Van Halen was like that. You know, like if you listen to Spanish Fly, ripping on a Ovation classical, it's probably worth $200. But it sounds like Eddie Van Halen.
Speaking of Van Halen, I mean, obviously his passing has had a huge effect on everyone in the guitar community, but what kind of an impact did he have on you personally?
I mean, it's like losing Stevie again, you know, and Hendrix. And, you know, the thing about, you know, everybody, like, they never would associate me being a big Eddie Van Halen fan. Like, when I hear his stuff, like, especially early stuff, and I hear a blues rock guy, you know, that came up with some really inventive, powerful things. But it all just, I hear the blues in it. I mean, I hear like a lot of songs, you know, like even, you know, like Hot for Teacher and stuff like that. You know, it's like, let's do LaGrange on like, you know, 80, you know, and it was just his tone, how clean it was, you know. I could hear the Clapton, I can hear the blues, and then he just would take it somewhere else. You're like, you know, he was tremendously impactful to so many that you can't, you have to, you just go, you know, there's pre Eddie, post Eddie, that's it, you know. I mean, how many single humbucker Strats were before 1978, you know, one knob and a bunch of stripes on it. Now there's millions. You know what I mean? That's one guy. That's how much it changed the game.
Yeah, you can't say more than that. Pre and post Van Halen. That's for sure. I know that I'm taking so much of your time here, Joe. Final thing. I would be killed by Gibson if I didn't ask about your brand new Epiphone Black Beauty. Can you tell us a little bit about the new guitar?
Well, yeah, we've done a lot. We've done probably 9 signature Epiphones, and what we've been doing in the last 4 or 5 years is we'll take one of my old guitars and we'll recreate it at a $799. I think it's probably same in the UK pounds. And one of the things about the Epiphone, anything they build, they're tremendously consistent, and for the money, it's a tremendously good value and a good guitar. Whether you like Joe Bonamassa or not, you can pick it up, they come set up pretty well, and you can literally rule the world if you got a song and an idea. And this, I'm not usually associated with triple pickup customs, but my friend who's a big advocate for customs was like, I was waiting for you to discover the joys of the ebony fingerboard. I'm like, I never used to like them. I finally found a 58 that I really loved. And it wasn't pristine. So I could flip the magnet, I can have it refretted, you know what I mean? I could do all the things to the guitar that require that customs require to be real players, you know what I mean? I have 4 or 5 original ones that are pristine, that have, they call them fretless wonders because there's no frets. So, you know, Les wasn't a big string bender and he wanted the action super low. So that's what they built for him. But if you try to bend strings on a fretless wonder, you're like, this is not fun at all. And they choke. But if you actually put frets on them, they're monsters. they're monsters. And, you know, a lot of your favorite tones, especially in the 70s rock, are customs, you know, and because they bite, they have, they're angry sounding. And I've kind of discovered my love for angry sounding Les Pauls of late. So yeah, the response has been great on them. And you know, people, you know, it's like, I just want to make sure that, you know, people get a good value for the money.
Yeah. Well, I can't wait for us to get one and to try it. Look, Joe, thanks so much for taking some time to chat with us. Congratulations on Royalty.
And thanks, man.
And thanks again. Okay.
Cheers, dude. I'll talk to you soon.